For Shed Harvest, Dr. Shi Yan she has a PhD in agriculture related work, and she's also a young global leader under the World Economic Forum. So the YGL network, Young Global Leader, is a very exclusive network of young leaders that are creating change or having a huge impact in their respective fields. So it includes investment bankers and consultants, but also people into social impact. There are only about, 1,000 or so young global leaders in the whole world. So I was very happy to have the chance to talk to her and to hear from her about her organization and her work. So they practice two interesting methods. So I'll be sharing about the two. So the first one that they do is a community-supported agriculture. So the idea of the CSA model, right, is that you try to connect the producer and the consumer more closely instead of having so many intermediaries, right? Instead of having the wholesaler, then the supermarket, they try to connect it directly. So basically what you can do, you can order direct from the farm and subscribe to the farm, to the harvest or group of farms. So they practice the CSA model. And another thing they practice is the PGS model, which is the participatory guarantee system, which is a locally focused quality assurance system that depends on trust. So similar to the, when I introduced them, right, you can tell that they're focusing a lot on building trust and between themselves and their consumers and whatnot. So maybe one example is that, that they do is they actually organize children camps. So families can bring their children down during the holidays to have a camp at the farm so that the children understand what farming is. And I personally believe that once you understand and appreciate what farming is, right, you have a different relationship with food, and you will be less likely to waste food. Because you understand the resources, time, energy required to make food, you are less likely to waste food after that. So I understand the camp at the farm has two functions: to build trust with the family, and also to allow the kids to understand about food and how to grow food, and that also helps with the food waste problem. Because I think we are very detached from the farms. That's why we see the food that we consume as products that we pay for. And hence, if we waste it, it's our right to waste it. But I personally don't think that should be the mentality. Okay, so I'll be sharing about two other organizations that we visited, Cursing Farms and Alaska Life. So both are tech-focused initiatives. So Cursing Farms is a startup funded by Le Ping Foundation, which is a huge foundation in China. And they look at how they are looking at how to digitalize the agriculture sector in China. And they came out with an index. They are using an index by McKinsey Global Institute to measure, they mentioned a digital index and how they are using it to measure progress and adoption. And they realized that actually the agriculture sector is one that has a lot of potential to be digitalized. So they came up with a product credit evaluation system also, where they use big data and algorithms to solve the issue of trust. So earlier you mentioned, right, earlier I mentioned how Shed Harvest, they focus on human-to-human relationships. But here, they're trying to use technologies like IoT to solve the trust issue. So in China, they don't really trust their food, right? Because of various scandals, food scandals, sometime back. I'm not sure how many of you remember the milk, white rabbit sweet. That's one of my favorite sweets last time, but ever since the scandal, I haven't actually eaten the white rabbit sweet, but... Yeah, so the white rabbit sweet was one case, and then I think people don't really trust the food they eat. So technology is one way to solve it, to ensure that they don't put, they clearly indicate how much fertilizer they're using, how much pesticides they're using, etc., so that the food is still of decent quality. You eat, really nothing happened to you, that kind of thing. So they look at a lot of big data products to increase the efficiency of food production. And the other one is indoor farming, tech startup. This is purely business driven, and they have got multiple investors, and they actually built this container in Dubai, in Saudi Arabia, I think Middle Eastern countries, as well as Singapore. The Singapore government approached them also to explore setting up in Singapore. Given I think the interest has, because of COVID and climate change, I think they realized that Singapore, we need to get, they have a new goal now, 30 by 30. So 30% of imports, 30% of the food supply must be local by 2030. And they are pushing a lot of grants now to support this sector. But we'll see how this goes. Personally, I don't think that technology will be able to solve the issue, because even when I visited the guy, the founder, Stuart, he actually studied in Singapore in the American, Stanford American School. And then he went overseas to study for uni in Australia. And then he shared with me that, you know, there are still limitations with the tech because, you know, if you were to do things like potato or carbohydrates, the cost is a concern. Like the cost doesn't make sense for them to do carbohydrates. So I don't think tech will be the solution, but it might be. I mean, if it advances further, yeah. But for now, I don't think it will be. So the reason why I mentioned these two examples was because I think through this experience, I thought very deeply about the connection between technology and community. I remember this story that Cui Fen shared some time back about how in the community garden, they were considering to get sponsors, you know, to try to automate and reduce the amount of work that is needed on the community farm or community garden. Sorry, I'm not too sure what to call it, but you guys can imagine a patch of like greenery. So the idea was if they get a sponsor to come in to sponsor the irrigation system, then people will not need to carry pails every day to, you know, go and water the plants, right? But at the same time, right, that will mean that people will lose the opportunity to interact and build relationships. So my question is, the question I have in my head after the trip was, can we have both? Can we have both technology and community where we, you know, leverage on human relationships, build human relationships and trust, but at the same time also use technology to facilitate and increase efficiency without like neglecting either? I think that would be the best case scenario, but very often people focus on only one, as mentioned by the examples I shared. So that's the end of my sharing.